All right, perfect. Well, welcome everyone to today's class. My name is David Piatek. I'm going to be one of the speakers along with Christina. My background is I work at the Federal Savings Bank as a loan officer. I'm a real estate instructor in Virginia and a couple other states. I teach the MRP course and also an author of that course, and also serving in the military. So I have a big passion for helping the real estate community understand how to work with military members and also some of the nuances like VA home loan assumptions, which can seem confusing.
Hi, everybody. I'm Christina De Uribe. He skipped my last name. I know. He would. Everybody does. So I am with MBH Settlement Group. I currently manage the Winchester, Front Royal, and Warrenton offices. Prior to that, I managed McLean, Arlington, and Great Falls, though, so I'd like to think I have a breadth of experience from, you know, complicated lot line issues in Alexandria to handshake right-of-way deals in the mountains. So it takes a bit to get through all of that stuff, but I've been kind of everywhere. I still do closings everywhere. I do them in English and Spanish, as the name would suggest, and so... Well, and if I have agents that speak English and clients that speak Spanish, I charge a little bit extra for Spanglish. really excited to be here today with David. I'm usually the main event, but this is his show for the most
part.
Our show. But happy, you know who the sidekick is when you see who got the regular mic versus the clip-on one. But very excited to be here to go through this with you guys and to help kind of put it all together from the beginning contract drafting perspective, yep, all the way to the closing. So happy to be here.
Yeah. Thank you. And so the reason why we put this class together is because there's a lot of, it can seem very confusing and very daunting. We did a couple of these presentations, and then you'll have people say, well, my experience was this, well, my experience was that, and it could be contradicting. The information we go over today is from the VA, right? The VA issues a VA handbook, which outlines some of these things that we talk about today. But the other piece to that is that there's a lot of things that are not written down that you actually have to reach out to the VA for to gather that information, which is what we're going to cover today. And if you guys have questions about the stuff we talk about today, it's also easy to verify this with the VA, which we're going to provide you those resources, because it can seem like, unlike other parts of the government, the VA regional loan centers actually know what they're talking about, and they are very knowledgeable in these subjects, right? So they'll be able to provide clarity for your clients. The agenda today is to go through what is a VA home loan assumption. We're going to talk about who can assume VA loans, because that can seem very confusing. And this also applies to military members, right, that have VA loans that might be scared to do an assumption because they think their benefits are automatically locked out of their property. We're going to talk about processing loan assumptions. So we're going to cover that from both sides, right? We're going to cover that from the VA side. And then how is that different than a regular contract? And really understanding those timelines that go with that. We're going to talk about how the VA home loan assumption could be used for divorce situations, which is something I recently learned myself. I didn't even realize you can do that. We're going to talk about how to work with sellers and buyers. We're going to talk about pros and cons to the program itself, right, and of that transfer. And then we're going to go through some different examples of how a second mortgage works with VA assumptions. Because I'm assuming that most of you have heard that you cannot do that, right? You've talked to your lending institutions and they say, well, that's just not possible. It is. And we're going to break that down. And then we're going to go through an example. So to kick things off, I want to show you guys the power of what an assumption really is for both a buyer and a seller in dollar-wise, right? Because that's what we want to. So we're going to use an example of a $700,000 purchase. If somebody has a balance of $500,000 and a 30-year mortgage, 2.25% rate, their payment's 1911, totaling with interest $688,000, right? So if you have someone comes in, they want to put up to $200,000, this is what they can get. Whoa, I don't know what just happened there. If you look at VA assumption, if you look at new purchase, just using like at 700,000, using market rates where they are today, they actually went up today, you'd be looking at about almost $1.6 million, right? So that's a significant amount more interest that someone is paying at today's rates versus them having the funds to assume the first, right? You're talking about what? it's close to what, like $900,000 in interest. So some of the questions we get from the real estate community is that, can I market my property for more because I am doing an assumption? Well, that's a question for you, right? And how you market that property. Because if I can tell a potential buyer, hey, you buy this and you save $900,000, is that a conversation worth having, right? So that's just something you guys have to think about. This example shows a second mortgage. So in this example, and I'll talk about this from my angle just because we do them, right? And I don't know anyone else that does them. So in this example, right, 5% down payment on the 700, so it's 35,000, second mortgage at 165, 15-year term, rate at 9.74, right? You're still saving about $600,000 to do that, even with a second mortgage, right? So it always comes down to the numbers, because even if you look at the bottom line payment, it's still going to be lower than taking out market rate, right? But a lot goes behind that of how to actually get from, hey, we have an assumption, to we're at the closing table, and then the seller's reusing their benefits. So that's what the majority of this is. And we're always going to come back to that. So when, you guys can get the video's going to be posted online, and then you guys can get a copy of this PowerPoint. This is my PowerPoint, so yeah. That's why we switched it from a panel to a PowerPoint, because like it's just so much information to go over, and it just would be hard to retain without this. So that's why we do this. So the VA loan, the VA assumption is where military members have the ability to transfer their mortgage to a potential buyer. That's going to include the assumption itself, right, is the balance and the terms of the mortgage. So if I have been paying my mortgage, let's say I have a 30-year original mortgage, which most likely would have originated in the last 3 years, right? And let's say I've paid 12 months of that down, and so I have, do we have to reboot anything? We got IT in here.
Wing it.
Oh, yeah, no, there's a lot that goes behind this. So if someone paid down 12 months, you're actually taking over a 29-year mortgage, right? You can't, and it includes the balance itself, so it comes almost down to the penny, right? So if it was a $500,000 original balance, now it's $495,200. That's what they're taking at the day of closing. It's basically the mortgage plus the interest on the day of closing is what the buyer is going to be assuming. They cannot recast that, right? So sometimes people are like, well, if I take over the mortgage, can it recast to another 30-year mortgage? It can't. It has to be the exact dollar amount. It also requires that the original entitlement be assumed by the buyer. Do you guys know what entitlement is on VA loans? Right? Most of you guys do. For the folks that don't, entitlement is the amount that you basically, because I just did this yesterday, a whole class on this. But it's kind of something that's hard without having like all the in front of you. So entitlement is the amount of money you can actually borrow, right? But it's also the amount that that locks into a property. So if you buy a $1 million property, right, the VA guarantees 25% of that. You lock out $250,000 of your benefits, right? 25% of that. So even if you took out a $1 million mortgage and the balance dropped to $500,000, the incoming veteran would have to qualify for the $1 million entitlement, even though the balance is $500,000. Right, so that's, you can't pay it down. That doesn't exist. You have to be, why it's relevant is when people have multiple VA loans, because you can, right? You can have as many VA loans as you want. You have a question?
No.
Okay. Yeah, so that's a key factor for someone coming in as a buyer, because they have to have the full entitlement at times, right? Oh, I think you might have unclicked me. All right, cool. There's no appraisal or termite inspection required on a VA assumption. Unless you get a second mortgage, that's the only time it would be required. So basically, they're buying it as is, because the VA originally guaranteed that loan. You're just transferring those terms to the new buyer. Now, when it comes, and the servicer is the one who actually controls the assumption. Lender, like if you have a client that's pre-approved with somebody, they're not using that lender for the actual assumption. They're going through the servicer, which we're going to give you guys some tips on how to work with them. Now, the thing with servicers, we've had a mixed bag of feedback for people doing these, right? Sometimes they could take 45, sometimes it's 30 days, 45 days, 2 months, 3 months, and we hear as far as 4 months out. And then we hear them 3 months, and all of a sudden the servicer changes, and they have to restart that whole process, right? So it can be painful, but this is what, like, we're going to go through that with some of the downsides for the sellers on that. But because the servicers control it, you're at their mercy for the entire process and the timeline. Right, yeah. So, but they also can make it really tight on their requirements, so they don't do them. It's a right; they don't necessarily have to do them.
So, it's my understanding that the obligation of the servicer is controlled by something called VA Pamphlet 26.7. I'm interested in any, as you go through, any compliance commentary you have on that, because under that guidance, which runs the people under and the servicer as well as the VA. They're supposed to process these loans within 30 days. I use that as leverage against the servicer to behave better. It's worked occasionally.
The problem is that over the last 30 years, rates have gone down. And my assumptions used to be popular back in the day, but they're not popular anymore. And so now with the market changing, market changed very rapidly, and they just don't have the staff to do all these assumptions. Because remember, assumption loans include VA loans, FHA loans, and USDA loans. You can assume all of them. And right now, we also have a lot of veterans like that are assuming FHA loans, just because it's not a bad product, right? Especially if you get the lower interest rates. But we're going to cover that on how to do appeals with the VA. So it's still a regular transaction. So I'll let Christina kind of talk about that sale. Like, what's so different about when you're going into this contract for an assumption?
Sure. I would say, well, there's two things we worry about being different, right? The closing itself and contract drafting, basically. From a practical standpoint as an agent, how do you put together a contract that makes sense to account for the assumption? The closing itself, you guys, is pretty much exactly the same. It's super, super simple. The fees tend to actually be a little bit less. You're not paying for certain fees on the buy side, like origination points and such. So I would say closing costs on the buy side tend to be lower even with the assumption fee, which is half a point?
Yes.
Half a point. And so fees tend to be lower. Difference in timing, obviously, as David mentioned, so you want to account for the fact that it can have a longer processing time. So when you're drafting your contract, I tell people almost treat it like it's a short sale, right, in your brain, just in that we're relying on a third party to give us an approval, and we're not sure how long they're going to take. Yes, they should do it in 30 days, but it's common to see it take longer. So account for that in setting your closing date so that you don't land your buyer in a situation of potential default because you didn't give them enough time to get approved for the assumption. And then the other aspects of contract drafting that are different is just that for 20, 30 years, we have completely glanced over the assumption checkbox, right? So it was so irrelevant that NVAR at a certain point took it from that financing section in our main contract and added it to the addendum, just with a couple checkboxes that are relevant and important, but it's no longer a part of that main bulk of information in the contract itself. So what you would do when drafting is have your financing addendum attached, the same as you would do normally, but make sure that you're checking off that an assumption is going to take place, it is still an option. And then there's a little paragraph below that people love to forget is there. And it's a really, really important paragraph in that contingency form. The paragraph asks whether the buyer and seller are going to obtain a release of liability for the seller. Almost any seller in their right mind would want a release of liability for themselves. Very rare circumstances, which we can maybe touch on a little bit later, where a seller might not want one or might not need one, family members, that type of thing. But it's going to be rare. And the other checkbox has to do with a substitution of the entitlement. So do buyer and seller want to obtain a substitution of the seller's entitlement? The answer to that for any seller in their right mind would almost also be yes as well, right? So The paragraph is small. It's below the main section in that financing contingency. So I would say the same as I say in any class when I'm talking about contract drafting. Don't do one contract the same as you've done the last one, the same as you've done the last one, because the more comfortable we get in routine, the easier it is to skip over a paragraph or a checkbox that happens to be really, really, really important. Yes?
We're going to cover that shortly. Like, we're going to do a whole section on that.
Yeah, we'll definitely touch on that in detail. But it is, just generally speaking, it is true that a veteran or non-veteran can assume, and it affects the ability to substitute the entitlement. Yes?
Are you using the VA financing contingency then on the assumption?
Exactly. Yep, VA financing contingency. The only other side note I'll make as far as contract drafting goes is... And something else that David, I'm sure, is going to touch on is that oftentimes you have a buyer that's pursuing an assumption and at the same time is simultaneously pursuing other type of financing just in case the assumption doesn't work. And so it's a possibility to land yourself in a situation where you're wondering if you should have a contingency to protect for two separate options. And that isn't something that our contract is set up to allow you to check box off. And so... Remember to work, you know, I say one of the biggest problems with assumptions, if I were to state what I think the challenges are, is just that we misconstrue it as complicated when really it's just unfamiliar. So work with attorneys at MBH. call me. You guys will have my contact information. Don't land yourself in a situation of trying to draft legal language in contracts, but if you have questions as to how you need to set up a unique situation, just ask, right? We can walk you through it. We can make sure that the buyer and seller are both protected. Yes?
You said that the assumption is the subject of approval. Who approves?
Servicer.
So, yeah, so the servicer is the one that controls it, right? Depending on how the servicer is set up. They have direct authority or they have to rely on the VA. But you can also appeal that, which we're going to go through. A lot of people don't realize you can't appeal these things.
Yeah.
Right? And I guess that'd be the hard part, too, in this, is that if you're going in on a contract, if the servicer has certain overlays, they might get denied. So let's say if you have a VA loan and I apply and I get denied for that, I could walk away from the contract? Or you're saying there's no way to put, hey, you have VA pre-approval, so you can actually do it. Buying it outright or the assumption?
You can craft that, right? But it's not something that you want to be crafting alone by yourself for fear of just, you know, unauthorized practice of law. So if it's that type of situation where you want protection for another type of financing as a backup, I would say, just reach out. You can do it. It's possible. I've seen it before. The traditional way, if you're just, let's say the buyer is like, I don't want the house if I can't get the assumption, right?
Right.
That's easy because you draft that contingency just as an assumption. You check off assume a loan. And one of the big things in this whole process is going to be communication between listing agent and selling agent. Because it does matter what terms the seller has. It does matter what their existing balance is. We're going to talk a lot about that kind of gap between the two. So communicate, because when you put that contract together, you're going to need to know the terms that you're pursuing on the assumption in order to even draft the contingency.
There's a lot more sharing involved.
Yes.
That's the problem. And then we've run into that where we're like, hey, have the sellers provide their certificate of eligibility. We need their mortgage statement. And they're like, no, we don't want to do that. Well, then we don't have an assumption. Like, so just be aware of that. And like to her point too, is like, isn't an advantage where if the client's only gonna do the assumption, because if they don't qualify, you're then back on the market again, right?
Right.
So.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
For a case that the seller is a VA loan and the buyer is a regular person.
We'll talk about that in a second.
I have a question. If the sales price is, for instance, $1 million and the assumption is $500,000, that person needs to apply for a regular loan to cover for the other half, that is the total sales price of the property.
So that'd be like a second mortgage. Yeah, so you would have to get a second mortgage to cover it, or just cash difference.
So I guess I took this class, I'm doing a first assumption with VA. My client has VA status as well. So I put in the contract, I'm just looking at it, 60-day financing contingency. They crossed it out for 30 days. We got our first call from Freedom Bank. It took us just 3 weeks for somebody to call us.
Right.
And then today's lead person, anyway. So we got it, and now they're saying, oh, it could take up to 90 days.
Right. That's the downside of doing
some
of these.
So how do I protect myself? I mean, should I send an addendum or something specifying to your...
Yeah, in the contract, did you do the automatic extension financing?
Yes, I did. Yes.
So, I mean, the automatic extension is nice because the financing contingency will automatically extend unless somebody prompts it to end, right?
Right.
So that would always be the goal, right? If you're doing one of these, pick the financing contingency option with the automatic extension. You can ask for an extension, but if they haven't asked you to stop it, it automatically extends, right, all the way up until your closing date. So you do have protection in and of the way you've drafted it.
Oh. Sure. Would it be beneficial if the listing agent would ask the servicer for the conditions of what the assumption is so they would know that up front?
Very much so.
Yeah, and we're going to cover that as well.
A must.
Yeah. Because there's different steps on the buy and the sell side that you're going to have to go through on getting the information up front so you can advise in the best way. Because, yeah, it could be tricky.
Did she say that IBA says you have to do it in 30 days?
Yes, but, I mean...
I'm running, just, you know, to be clear for people, I'm doing a fair number of these, and I'm running into situations where some servicers are basically just unabashedly saying, I'm sorry, we're only going to talk to the applicant. We refuse to talk to the settlement attorney. We refuse. There are a couple of them with MBAs. We refuse to talk to the listing agent. We refuse, you know. I've done some things to get around that, but you have to be prepared to think outside the box, whether that's engaging a separate attorney to force that process, you know, to make a servicer comply with the law.
Is there anything that you used in your experience to get them to open it up, or is it internally they have it set? Because the VA doesn't have anything set on that.
A lot of this seems to be, particularly for not for Main Street banks, like a U.S. bank or Wells Fargo, these kind of guys, it's all internal process. And so you pretty much, as Christine knows, I'm also an attorney, and so I change hats.
Right.
And then send a letter. And you just got to get them to comply with the law.
Right.
They take advantage of the idea that none of us
know what this
is. Are going to be educated enough to push
them off. The unfamiliarity goes in both directions, right? So I do think in a market where, you know, we've been for so many years at interest rates where most of our veterans have 2-3% interest rate loans, we're now sitting at 6.5%. Who knows what the future brings? We're not doing that in this class. You know, as we see more of them, it's going to get easier. It just is, as a matter of course, because I think they're going to be hiring more staff. They're going to be, you know, designating a team to deal with these kinds of things. I think that sometimes when you get a servicer on the other end of the line who, you know, maybe doesn't even originate VA loans very often to begin with, they're completely dumbfounded as to what their steps would even be. So it does take some pushing, but hopefully with time we'll see improvement.
That's all right.
Servicer also the owner of the loan, or the servicer will also go to the owner?
No, the servicer is the one that controls the whole piece.
Okay.
This wasn't a VA loan, but I actually did have a client who needed to talk to the servicer. There's a couple different options because it was a 30-day process. So I did get on the phone. I had the Social Security number. I had enough information about it where they would talk to me with certain information. Then there was other times where he was elderly. He would get on the phone with me, and they would give a 48-hour, okay, you are allowed to talk to us for 48 hours. They take your information down, so anytime you need to talk at 48 hours, they'll talk to you. But then I would have to renew it again in 48 hours. So there are ways that you do have to get creative with talking with the server.
Yeah, so the way what they're talking about is that you basically give authorization to the parties to talk, to be able to know about your information. That's what we're talking about. So let's pop back to this. You still have to pay transfer taxes if they apply. The other piece to that is you have to still pay real estate commissions if that applies. You still have to record a deed at closing. Then the processing times are going to vary. But another point that Christina made was that the cost of the loan is much cheaper, right? If veterans use Main Street banks, the closing costs are the highest out of any loan product because of discount points and origination fees. But they don't have to pay any of that. They still have to pay a VA funding fee, but we'll go through that. Buyers still have to pay their equity, if any. That could be in the form of cash, money market, retirement accounts. Military members a lot of times have TSP accounts, especially out here. They have a lot of money in them, right? This is not like a couple bucks. Like, they don't even have $1 million+ in those accounts. And what they can do, I'm not a financial advisor, but we see this all the time, and I have a TSP account myself, is that you can withdraw from it for the purposes of buying a primary residence, right? You take a loan on against it without a penalty. Right, so for a lot of folks, they don't even know that's an option, and you'll still be paying yourself back, but at a very marginal interest rate. Right? It'll be very small. They do allow for second mortgages. Sometimes people will tell you that you cannot. I know for a fact that you can because we do them. They can be fixed mortgages or home equity lines of credit. And then the other option is that people can do a seller second. Have you run into seller seconds?
Yeah, we're seeing them actually more often lately than we had been, and just seller financing in general. So when it comes to using a seller second to kind of bridge the gap between the assumption amount and your sales price, it's very similar to what you would see on a transaction just with seller financing in general. So, you know, the seller is essentially loaning out of their own equity to the buyer to be able to finance that extra portion that's due. So the seller doesn't walk away with those funds at closing, but you set up a traditional type of mortgage that does get recorded in the county, whereby the seller is receiving monthly mortgage payments from the buyer. And this kind of does away with the need in situations where maybe a buyer couldn't be approved for a second or something like that, to at least get through that, to bridge that gap when needed, if you need kind of a creative resolution. You see it a lot with family members, friends, things like that. And even if it's family, we still record a deed of trust. We still have a promissory note. Family is always super, super nice until they're not or they're owed money. So we still have all of that documentation in place. And the attorneys at your title company at MBH can draft those documents if needed and just roll them into the transaction. It's really easy.
And an important thing to note when you do a seller second, you still... The person that's the seller, the first mortgage will be assumed by the new buyer, so you still get your fee benefits back. You just have a second mortgage. So now you can't use that money to pay it down on another property. But nobody does, a lot of people don't do these second mortgages for these properties, but guess what they do? They do refinances once you own the property. You can refinance a second, private second, into a commercial second pretty easy. So I don't know if you can you put clauses in, like must be paid off in 2 years? Is that I don't know how it works on the second part.
Yeah, you can put any clause in anything, right? And most of the time there's a way to enforce it. So certainly when doing that type of private financing, you could do like a balloon loan where you've got right. payments for a year, for 2 years, and then due in full to give the buyer the opportunity of time to refinance. So that's always a possibility. I'll add real quick too, I don't know if you have another bullet point, but we see gift funds a lot as well. So just remember, I think VA
allows
gift funds. Yeah,
you're allowed. I don't know if I have it. Oh.
Yeah, so I think VA, you're allowed to use gift funds.
Anybody
yeah.
can really give that money.
So again, gift funds are a possibility. They're typically going to be approved in this situation. So if you have a family member that's wanting to give $100,000 towards the transaction, then that's possible too.
Yeah.
What would be the advantage of any seller to get seller's financing as a second mortgage, besides being nice?
If they don't need the money, they just want their entitlement back, they have other assets, right? And they're able to unload their property.
Do they have to pay capital gains?
That's a completely kind of separate question, right? Based on how they bought it, what they bought it for, whether they've lived there. The same types of requirements for capital gains calculations are going to apply in these situations. So, but you would include that amount, okay? So if you were calculating capital gains, you wouldn't exclude any seller financing amount. You would still be looking at your full sales price versus what they bought it for. Sellers, though, sometimes want to make a bit of interest. I mean, the interest rates on second loan seller financing typically, you know, analogous to or similar to what you would see on seconds, more like 9%, something like that. And it's a consistent stream of revenue, so sometimes they're happy to take that over a lump sum.
And if not, they take the house back. They foreclose on it, and they already have their equity that they have, right? So it's not a bad deal. So the VA allows for, I have a slide on that. But yeah, the VA allows for it if a the servicer shouldn't have any overlay on that. But most likely they do because, again, they're already thin and they might be like, well, we're not doing this. Do you guys know how many times can you transfer a loan to another? So if I assume a loan from Christina, can I then take that same loan, I assume that 2.25 and have it someone else, and then that person pass it on, that person pass it on? Do you guys know how many times you can do that? Unlimited times. So it keeps passing down. Now, where we see assumable loans are very relevant today, but I think past 7 years out, they're not going to be. Because at some point there comes a shift where there's too much equity. And then, like we just had this happen on a deal in Chicago, the seller had a $700,000 mortgage. They're selling the place for $1.4 million. So if a veteran wants to come in and say, hey, I'll fork up half that money, like no problem, the second mortgages a lot of times don't go up that high. They don't even be close to it. Like ours is capped at $350,000 for a reason, right? Like the second mortgages eat up a lot. So. And then also, once rates fall below a certain threshold, it won't make sense anymore because once you look at the blended rate, it won't make sense. And I'll also share, because like that sheet that I have an Excel sheet with that. So I'll share that when I share the PowerPoint. So you guys can be able to plug the numbers in and see if it makes sense. Because we don't want to be scaring people either. All right, so now we're going to talk about who can assume a VA loan. Anybody can assume it, but there's downsides to either portion, right? So non-military members locks in the seller's benefits into that property, right? So that's a downside. Now, it makes sense if it's family. Like, that's an easy one, right? Like, hey, my family's going to assume my property because, you know, it might be estate planning purposes, right? There could be different purposes for doing that. But non-military, or if you're not, if you're non-military, you can buy it as a primary or a second home or an investment property, right? There's no requirement for occupancy if you're non-military. For military, it does have to be used. You have to have enough entitlements. Remember, we talked about it's the original entitlement that they have to qualify for. If they don't have an outstanding VA loan, it doesn't make a difference. They don't have to qualify at the $1 million. They're qualifying whatever the current balance is and the current payment. But if they have an outstanding VA loan, then that kicks in. They can't pay it down. They can't recast the mortgage. It stays the same. It's got to be a primary residence. Now, a military member can assume someone else's mortgage without doing a substitution of entitlement, and they can just be an investor or a second home. Wouldn't make a difference. Just because they are classified as a veteran doesn't mean they can't be a non-veteran for the purposes of buying a property. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. The big thing on this, Christina touched on, is you have to do a substitution of entitlement in order for your benefits to swap. If you do not sign one of these, you're locking out the seller's benefits into that property. It's not required, though. So again, so if you don't sign it, you're kind of, so this is why you have to have the right team for this, okay? This is probably the most important takeaway, too, from this. we go to settlement, I'm the buyer, you're the seller, Christina's the seller. When we go to settlement, we sign this document. Her benefits are still locked into that property for another 30 to 60 days. My benefits go on that property also 30 to 60 days because the VA is the one who does the switch. It's different than if you were to do a regular buy and sell because VA loan, hey, I'm using my VA loan to buy your place. Same day, we swap. My benefits get put on, your benefits get released the same day, and it goes. The risk you run into that is if the servicer made a mistake, and let's say they let me assume your mortgage, but they shouldn't have let me assume because they didn't have enough entitlement because I have another outstanding VA loan, then I would lock in your benefits into this property. So this is why you have to be very careful. We probably should have done a class like on understanding how to read a certificate of eligibility, but... Yeah, if he doesn't want to use his VA loan.
He doesn't need to use VA eligibility anymore.
Right. Yeah, you just have to do, there's some other things you have to do, like a release of lien, right? But then if they go into foreclosure, then all that gets locked out for the buyers. I don't know if it happens as far as if it dings them on their credit reports, because I've seen them recently with older veterans where they have had assumption loans, like someone else assumed it, they went into foreclosure, but it wasn't on their credit report, but it was on their certificate of eligibility.
So what David's pointing out here is extremely important, especially if you have military that are moving from a different part of the country and they're selling a house there. You have to communicate with the listing agent on the other side and make sure that follows up. Because if they want to use that entitlement here and it's not released there, everything's going to fall apart. So it's really, really key that you talk to your military person who's still coming in, as well as everybody's communicating. That's right. The whole thing I think that everybody needs to realize again is you have to communicate.
So in that scenario, it's like, let's say someone has a house in California, they want to come to here in Virginia, and they want to assume a mortgage here. They have a home listed for sale out there. They can still technically go under contract, but they won't be able to close on the assumption until they're sold the other property. Does that make sense? Right, so you have to be careful of that because you don't want it to overlap. And then your buyers, your sellers, cannot buy for another 30 to 60 days because their eligibility isn't released to them.
So practically, you guys, what this means is coinciding settlements on the same day, sitting at the table trying to knock it out on the sale, including an assumption and a purchase using an entitlement is not going to work.
No.
And so remember these practical takeaways, because this all goes into, unfortunately, the very, very beginning of contract drafting and planning and talking to your clients, because if you don't think of that and you plan for a coinciding, you're going to land yourself in a pretty big mess. So we've seen people use, a combination of unique and creative solutions, rent backs and things like that, all
right.
Kinds of stuff to make it doable for a seller who wants to reuse their entitlement and doesn't want to get into a contract where they're going to potentially be in default. So flexibility on both ends, right? And tons and tons and tons of communication.
Right. We've toyed around the idea, just like where I work, to be like, can we do extended locks and just have them close? But then again, you need all the information from all the parties. So not everyone wants to be like, oh, here's all my information. They don't want to do that, right? So that's the issue right now we've run into, is when we ask for simple documents like, hey, let's look at your certificate of eligibility. Let's get your mortgage statements. They're like, who are you? Like, why do you want this? Because it's going to be relevant for the next phase of this. This is new. Though people get used to it, as usual. And again, it's 30 to 60 days after closing.
Can I ask one question? Back to who can assume the VA home loan.
Mm-hmm.
If you're military and you want to buy it for investment, you can't because it has to be a primary residence, correct?
Okay. So if you're going to be doing a substitution of entitlement in your military, it has to be primary. But if just because like I'm in the military, I can come in as a civilian and say, well, I'm going to lock out your benefits. I'm going to buy it as an investment property. And I'm going to lock. Yeah, so you can do it that way. But if I'm like, hey, we're going to swap benefits. I'm going to, you know, free up yours. I'm going to put mine on there. Has to be a primary residence.
Thank you.
Yeah. So two things, being eligible and being qualified, are two very different things. Most veterans are eligible for the VA home loan. But you still need to qualify with income, credit, assets, and it's servicer specific. I could talk about just this one thing for 2 hours all day long, right? Just in the MRP course, I teach it. But the standards are very different among different lending institutions in general. And then the VA, because the VA is very loose on what the requirements are. you know what it is? I think I know what it is. Okay. So when it comes to the servicer, again, the person has to, you know, some of them look at credit, some of them don't. Like, we've heard stories of people come in, they won't do a credit review. They just look at their income documents. You can appeal the decision of the servicer with a VA appeal or a special appeal, but we're going to break that down in a different section because there's different things that you can do. If you go off the VA handbook, it might do you no good because, again, I've talked with the VA about this, and then since the servicer is the one that's controlling it, they could place their own overlays. Like, VA loans don't have debt-to-income requirements. They have what's called residual income. But lenders put DTI restrictions on VA loans, right? So this servicer might do that. And I think someone else mentioned, too, is that some servicers don't all originate. They just do servicing. Right, so they're protecting their own assets by having stricter requirements. Right, VA technically doesn't have a credit score requirement, but who's going to lend to someone with a 500 credit score that hasn't made a single payment on time for the last 2 years? Right, and yeah, so that's kind of like the things that are at play with this. There's three additional things that need to happen. Loan must be current or brought current at the time of closing. Make sure that your sellers are still paying their mortgage. One. Right, just because you're going through this assumption process, nothing is finalized until it's closed. And you can, again, it can be brought current at the time of closing. Prospective buyers must be credit worthy, right? So credit collateral capacity. And then also the prospective purchaser agrees to assume all the loan obligations, including the obligation to indemnify the VA if a claim is paid, meaning that you went into foreclosure and the VA had to make that payment. We're in a very tight box that we can be in for video. Yeah, so there's three things that need to be met. It can be brought current at the time of closing as well, so just kind of keep that in mind. The VA funding fee. It's 50 basis points, so 0.5% for using this assumption. What's different about assumptions is that it cannot be rolled into the mortgage. It has to be paid for up front. You can still do seller credits. So if the sellers want to give a credit of blank amount of dollars to cover those fees, they can do that as well. Nothing changes on that front. If the veteran buying has a service-connected disability, then that VA funding fee is waived on the purchase. Automatic authority, where lender controls the approval process, is typically going to be a little bit easier. It's supposed to be much faster, but as we've seen, it's not. For 50 basis points, so have a. Oh, you just need to have a. It's based on the VA. So, technically, I've been through TAPS a couple times in the last 2 years that I deployed recently, and they'll tell you that it's 10% or more. It's not necessarily true because we have veterans that have 0% rating, and they get their VA disability waived, because when you go through the VA disability process, you could be assigned a 0%, meaning you are service connected. But you don't have enough of a disability to warrant a percentage. So always request your certificate of eligibility to determine that. And there's also been significant changes with that as far as like National Guard and Reserve members, because they actually are allowed to be able to buy much sooner than most people realize they can. And the certificate of eligibility can be requested if you go to benefits.va.gov. I did a whole video on this recently. So yeah, they can go and get it themselves. They can talk to a lending institution like WePull. It's just like literally, like it's social and date of and their year of birth, and I could pull a certificate of eligibility. If it doesn't pull back automatically, you got to submit a DD-214 or like NGB-22 form, right? Or like statement of service if you're on active duty. But that's probably the most important document for the buyers and the sellers to get. And the sellers or buyers can get it themselves pretty easy. Lender fees are much lower, as we talked about. Just closing costs on the from a regular mortgage are significantly higher, right? You're only paying $300, $250. Escrow accounts do not revert to the sellers, right? Just like the mortgage balance to the penny is going to be transferred to the new buyer, the escrow account also transfers to the buyers. The sellers don't get that money back, right? So that's have you run into that being an issue with folks, or for someone that does a lot, are they like, why, I want that money back?
We put a clause and basically make sure that transfer occurs.
It would happen. Right. It wouldn't be from the loan reimbursement. That is a negotiated item to say, oh, I have $8,000 in there. Well, you're going to give me $8,000, but you're not actually swapping it out in the actual loan itself, right? It's just more of a us talking about it, right?
Yeah, well, we've seen it for sure. Kind of just, you know, transferred. We're not supposed to transfer outside of closing, right, if the lender isn't aware of what's taking place. So I have seen it as a prorated item on the settlement statement, but it's always going to depend on the servicer, and that's why a lot of what we talk about is pretty generalized because, you know, they could have a program that doesn't allow that transfer to take place on the statement. It's all about setting expectations. I think the only time I've seen it really be a problem is in situations where the seller was completely unaware, right? And then I'm sitting at the settlement table with them and I'm explaining their payoff or, or their assumption and how it's taking place. And, oh yeah, you're not actually gonna get that $4,000 back. And so you don't want it to be a surprise. So learning about the program, being able to address those things up front allows you to maybe negotiate for it, and if not, at least make them aware.
So just kind of want clarity on my being selfish here. So that escrow accounts. So basically my buyer's benefiting because we don't have anything in the contract right now. So the escrow is on the 7th.
Yeah, they don't have to reset it up. They just get it. You just move on with life. So it's cheaper in that sense too. You don't have to reset it up. Yeah, because you're taking on the current mortgage. Nothing, you're not paying interest, you're not setting all that up. Everything's already set up for you. You just step right in and roll.
I'm not sure I heard you correctly. Did you say that the lender may or may not allow the buyer to give the seller a credit on the ALTA for the amount of escrow?
Correct. May or may not, depending on the servicer, their requirements, whoever's approving it.
So it's more of like a accounting question. Because the VA itself says you cannot change it. The how you put it on the statement is just how you move the money around. It's like a good accountant. You know, it's tax season.
And what you call it, right?
And what you call
and
it.
And what you call it.
Right, and it's...
So in order to not set off red flags, we're not going to put a line item on the ALTA statement that says, you know, reimbursement to seller of escrow account balance. You can negotiate for credits all day long, right? So whatever those terms are can generally be rolled in. But if they start to question it and you have to provide, you know, evidence of some sort, then you've got to be forthright about it.
Or increase the purchase price by the amount of the escrows.
Oh. Do the escrow accounts stay as escrows when it's rolled over, or is it money back to the buyer?
No, it's rolled over. No money's changed on that front. It's just rolled over to the buyer. Yeah, so an example, you know, you close on the 28th of February, taxes are due March 1st, they just pay them as usual, nothing changes. Just the name of who basically is on the mortgage for that. You still have to sign a release of liability, right? If the new owner defaults on the mortgage, it won't affect the seller. So that's a positive thing. You can do a VA appeals, meaning that I apply for Christina's property, they deny me, and I'm like, no, I am credit worthy. Then buyers or sellers can initiate that. and that's done directly with the VA. Now, I've talked with the VA about this, and yes, because the program is so loose in its requirements, they did it on purpose, so banks would have to put their own overlays on certain things, like having no credit score is kind of crazy, right? So that's why certain different lending institutions have different requirements for that. When it comes to, so if you say, like, I want this buyer to buy, or buyer's like, I am qualified, just remember that delays the process even more because now the VA has to review this. And just because it meets VA's requirements, because sometimes we get people on the phone that are really good with Control F on a PDF, and they're like, I found this. This is what the VA said. I'm like, I get that. But in real practice, this is how it actually is going to be applied. Right, and the same thing here is the VA, they'd be like, well, there's no minimum credit score, but the VA is going to be like, well, they're the ones who control the mortgage. You're making payments to them. They have a right to say, well, we don't want to comply to this piece, right? That's why overlays exist. Now, you can do a special approval for appeals. This is where the seller agrees to stay secondary on the mortgage. Now, what sane person would do this? I don't know. Unless you really like somebody or family members, right? That's an easy one to have family members. Again, this could be like an estate planning purposes. This is also where the seller is just not able to sell their property and they need to get out of it. But again, you're locking out your benefits when you do that. So there's a downside to that. And you're also responsible for that mortgage payment. So if something happens, you are then liable for that. And then sometimes when people screw up and you don't sign off on all the proper documents, you can go back to the VA to so they can identify you from the mortgage. Like, let's say they screwed something up when they were doing the release, they didn't do it correctly. You can go back to them and say, hey, like, this was done incorrectly. They forgot, they didn't sign the release of lien or didn't sign the substitution of entitlement. You can do that, providing that the other party is going to work with you on that. VA assumptions for divorce situations. So this is, again, something new that I learned in the last couple of months. Divorce has, so let's say I'm the veteran. Oh, no, I'll have my spouse be the veteran. Yeah, I'll be the ex. Right, so she's the veteran, she has the house, and then I'm on my way out, right? But, or I want to keep that property, and I want her out of that property. Right, the divorce has to be finalized. There's no VA funding fee that is gonna be charged in those situations. The thing is with that is they still have to qualify for that loan, and I would have to, and then basically I would take that over, but then I would lock her benefits out. Okay, so that's the downside to that. Okay. But then the other person, unless we're both military, then it's pretty easy, right? Military, you can assume someone else's military, swap benefits, and you're good to go. So I've seen that happen. I've seen a recent divorce situation where the veteran departed his residence, and part of the divorce settlement paid off the mortgage for his spouse with his VA loan. Now, that did something weird because it actually locked in his benefits into that property even though there's no mortgage on there. You would have to request what's called a one-time restoration. Now, the problem with a one-time restoration is that it'll release you one time to buy another VA property. But what he failed to realize is that in order for him to use the VA loan again, both properties must be sold. So then, because it's a life benefit, right? There's tons of positive things with the VA loan, but that's the one time that people don't realize about if you pay down your mortgage. It's like when you pay down your mortgage with a VA loan, you can't refinance it with a VA loan because you can't do a cash out refi on a zero balance loan. There's some like quirky things. This is why we're here, guys. Answer all these questions. Now, it's an easy process when the veteran is awarded the property and the ex-spouse may seek a release of lien. So this is where, and we run into this currently, where people are like, oh, I'm getting a divorce, but I got a 2.25% interest rate. My spouse is on the mortgage, and by court order, I was told to remove them, right? You can actually just remove them without going through that whole process, right? You have to call the regional loan center, and they will take care of that for them, right? So you won't get a sale. I won't get a deal, but, like, it's a much better deal for the clients to be able to do that. But like I said, I didn't know up until a couple months about that.
You guys, I'll add real quick. This is an incredible thing to be able to do for divorcing couples. Number one, veterans' divorce rate is higher. Okay, so military homeowners divorce over 50% is their rate of divorce as compared to other people or the general public. So it does happen quite often. Mm-hmm. And one thing I'll say just from experience, no one in here is a divorce attorney, right? Okay. Divorce attorneys have no idea about this, okay? They really have absolutely no idea. And half the time, they have no idea about very simple things like return of escrow accounts and how to handle taxes, and they don't account for the things that we talk to our clients about sitting at the settlement table when they're going through a divorce, right? I, through my law firm, work with divorcing couples a lot, not necessarily on VA loans, but just on this regular process, right? They have a conventional loan, let's say. On a conventional loan, there's never going to be a such thing as a release of liability for one party or the other. And it's a whole ordeal, right? Especially the ones I'm working with now that have divorce decrees signed that say they have to refinance the property, and the poor person refinancing the property doesn't want to do so at 6.5% when they've got a 2.75. So knowing that this exists, even though it's not going to be a part of your everyday real estate transaction business, is super, super helpful. If you have clients that are talking about, you know, reaching out to you because they're going through a separation, if they're veterans, bring it to their attention, because their attorney most likely 99.9% of the time will have no idea to do so. Then they'll go through the process. They'll sign a settlement agreement, they'll have a divorce decree that doesn't account for this, and then they'll be trying to backtrack when they find out. So just know it exists. It's a really cool, really awesome way to get around some of the struggles that people go through.
And this is like heading deep into the guidelines too.
Yeah, only with VA.
Only with VA. I mean, it could be with FHA, I'm not sure. I know with VA for sure. FHA's got some quirky things to it. Working with sellers, right? Make sure, like we've talked about this, make sure that they talk with the servicer to gather all the contact information for the buyers. You want them to walk through that process, because qualification standards could be a little bit different. And I recommend that the realtor be on the call. Now, in these cases, you are going to have a financial knowledge of what, if buyer or seller, right? Buyer, you need to, you're gonna, there's no loan officer involved, right? There's just a servicer. And so you're going to have to help. These are all the documents we need to gather, and we're working on that right now to actually put like a CE class together for something like this, with just going over a lot of the basic information that's required on VA loans, some of the misconceptions around it. Every servicer has a different process. Right, you've experienced that. Everyone is just going to have a different process, but what they all are going to have in common is the documents they need to review, right? The financial picture. And then the release of lien and the substitution of entitlement. Like, I had an agent email me recently, like, hey, they've sent this to us before we just went under contract. Like, well, these documents actually get signed at closing. You need to review the certificate of eligibility for the seller, because you need to know how much entitlement is actually locked into that property. Again, veteran coming as a buyer doesn't need to worry about the entitlement, because they don't have a restriction, right? Because of the Navy Veteran Vietnam Act that they passed in 2019. It's not that, but it's close to it. But again, that's if buyers have outstanding VA loans. You need to know that, because they can't pay it down. They have to assume the exact dollar amount that's required. Servicer requirements could be different for veterans and non-veterans. So you need to know that, right? Is there a DTI restriction for one and not another? The most common one I hear is that VA loans get like a 55% debt-to-income ratio, right? Which is, again, not true. It's higher than that because of residual. But then non-veterans might have a different standard that you want to know what that is in the event your seller is entertaining that. And then also if the servicer allows for a second mortgage and if there's any restrictions with that. What I've heard with VA loans, there is none, but with, like, let's say with FHA mortgages, they'll tell you, like, oh, it's 90% max loan to value with a second mortgage, or they'll tell you 80%. And I'm like, well, this kind of defeats the point of doing these. But again, with VA loans, there is no restriction on those per the VA. Loans don't have to be transferable. They don't have to have the same rate. It's whatever the lender wants to do. They only care about the first mortgage, and that's it. Time frame of a buyer, right? You know, if it's 30 days, great. We're in a normal transaction. But if it bumps out to 90 days or longer, like what's the plan? Contingency plan, we touched on that, is that should you write the contract both ways? I have the buyer be both qualified for a pre-approval to buy it outright and assume it. And I'll tell you the importance of that soon. And then we talked about next financing, is that if somebody can't buy another home and they need their benefits because they're the sellers, how would you work that in? Right? Like, we've toyed around with the idea of doing that where, I think I mentioned where I work, but then you have to do extended locks, right? It's, you'd have to be a higher interest rate. So there's a downside to that, right? Do the buyers pay a higher premium so they can give extra money to the sellers to buy down their rate for the next property because of that change? And then rates go up, seem to go up all the time as it is, right? They drop for a little bit and then they back up again. And if you want to create a mark, this is, again, where I get a lot of pushback. Is that, hey, if you want to create a flyer for doing these first and second mortgages, we need a certificate of eligibility and a mortgage statement from the seller in order to determine how to actually structure it correctly for the incoming buyers.
How does it work when you have the entitlement, when a veteran, the veteran loan is assumed by a non-veteran, and then that non-veteran is assuming again or approving an assumption on a veteran?
You're asking too many good questions. All right, that was it. No more questions. So what she's saying is that if I assume, she's a veteran, I'm a non-veteran, I assume her loan, and we lock in those benefits. And then I'm non-veteran, and then a veteran comes in and assumes my mortgage, it has to be for the original amount. Always, it will always be the original amount. Note, important to know what the entitlement is. A lot of veterans did what's called interest rate reduction refinance loans, IRLs, back when the market was really good, right? So the last couple of years. An interest rate reduction refinance loan does not reset your entitlement. So if your original mortgage was $1 million and you bought it down to $500,000, you did an interest rate reduction refinance loan for the $500,000, your entitlement is $1 million. The only time it would have changed is if you did a cash out refinance, it would have changed your entitlement amount. Otherwise, it stays the same. So this is why trust but verify. If someone's like, oh no, I refinanced 3 years ago, I only have a balance of 500,000. No. That's why you have to look at the certificate of eligibility to determine that. It's called an interest rate reduction refinance loan. IRRRL. IRRL. Earl. Not like your cousin Earl. For buyers, they should still be pre-approved for a regular mortgage. Now, some people will be like, I'm not doing a, this is my opinion, by the way. Like, if a client's like, I'm only gonna do an assumption loan, that's it. How serious are they about buying? Right, if they don't want to go a regular way, it might be affordability, right? But if it's an affordability question, they should get pre-approved, because they need to know where they stand with their financial picture around the assumption. Because if the VA, if they need to understand what their residual requirements are, they need to understand what their debt to income requirements. This will outline a picture for them to do that. Right.
So there has to be a lot of education with us that are going out there, and not saying we're experts, because we are not experts, but there needs to be a lot of education out there with those people that are coming in and wanting to do it. Because we in Northern Virginia have probably the most, except for maybe California, the most assumable properties around. Because I've talked to other agents around the country, and they're like, VA assumables? What are you guys talking about those for? So, we're in a different market.
Right. This is why we do this, the education. I did like a video on YouTube on just like a consumer edition, so like consumers can be able to look at this. It's a bit more digestible. It's like 16 minutes, not an hour and a half. Just because, yeah, so just kind of keep that in mind. Lender must review the certificate of eligibility. Remember, you want a buyer to be able to get that. You don't want any surprises. Why that? You say, well, how could the certificate of eligibility have a surprise? This happens to a lot of older veterans where they did do assumptions back a long time ago. They probably went to foreclosure. And I'm like looking at this. I'm like, you had a foreclosure. They're like, foreclosure? What are you talking about? And so this has happened more often than not in the last couple of months because of how much interest we get. Like we have a lot of older veterans right now that didn't realize that they still can use their benefits because back in the day it used to expire within a certain time period. So we have a lot of veterans that are like 80 years old buying their first places for the first time. It's kind of insane. So just kind of keep that in mind. But what happens is that if you sold a property with a VA loan, if your entitlement doesn't always get automatically updated on your certificate of eligibility, then it requires you to get like a track search from a title company, providing that they have a license in that state where that home is, and then they need to pull it to show like, yes, it was transferred, because we see these as old as 20 years out, like 20 years old. So just kind of keep that in mind.
I have a question with the release of liability. If the buyer is not military or veteran, is there any requirement that the owner, the seller, will get a release of liability, or that's something?
So you're saying non-military, if buys from a military, they still sign a release of lien of it because the
certificate of satisfaction.
If a non-military is buying from a military, and you have the entitlement of the original owner being used on the purchase, I don't believe that there is a release of liability. That entitlement is tied to the loan.
But you're both responsible for the payments. I mean, like, your entitlement is locked in as the seller. The buyer's responsible for the payment. But if the new buyer goes into foreclosure, your entitlement is locked into that property,
right,
and you lose that entitlement.
Yes.
That's what it is.
So it's limited in a sense.
Yeah, it's
I
like a limited release.
Say.
Why they don't release the liability itself? Not the entire, but just the liability. No?
Because you... Yeah, because you don't
have
eligibility to swap.
Like personal liability for payments will be released. It's just that your entitlement
Correct.
Is still tied to the loan. So
the seller's entitlement.
Exactly. So if something happens because, you know, essentially you're trusting them with your entitlement, it's going to be tied to it as well.
So if the buyer does not pay, you will affect the seller credit.
Right.
Yeah, and as I think David mentioned before, I'm not sure somebody did, it might show up on the certificate of eligibility for that seller, even if it doesn't show up on their credit.
Correct. That is correct. And another thing to know, I want to go back to the one-time restoration, which is very important. If I pay down, if I assume her loan and she's a veteran, and I pay down my mortgage to $0, she can request a one-time restoration and buy it one time and have to wait for me to sell my property in order for her to use the VA. So just kind of keep that in mind, right? So this is why we did this, because we have a lot of people just throwing it out there like, oh, like it is easy once you know it, but you got to know the details around it, especially with multiple loans. You need to keep buyers, everyone client's different, but you typically just need to gather tax returns, bank statements, pay stubs. That's typically what's required. And the time constraints and the contingency plan. Like she mentioned, a lot of people are coming in here thinking like, this is the end all be all. If I'm not doing this, I'm out. It's education, right? Markets are always fluctuating. Rates are always fluctuating. This is why institutions have invented refinancing. Right? And with VA loans, it's super easy. Talk about second mortgages, and then we'll wrap things up. Right, so loan to value depends on the lender and servicer. Like for us, we allow up to 5%, 5% minimum down payment. Typically, it's a portfolio product. That's why you don't really see them. Like you don't see Chase Bank doing these, right? Because they sell their mortgages in the secondary market. Some a lending institution actually majority of the time hold these, but that's why we went around that in the ways that let's say someone, a seller wants to do the second and then just put a clause balloon payment in there. Because once you own the property, it's easy to get that second mortgage. It's easy. You just have to know in general what those requirements are, which is typically 10% equity. So you might tell someone, like, hey, you got to do a 10% down payment. I'll do the second. And then in 2 years, you have to refinance out of it. Right? Because it'll be at the same terms, but you can basically get out of that. Minimum loan amount, like ours, is $50,000. Max is $350,000. But again, lenders could have different requirements. The VA loan limit for our Fannie Mae single family loan limit went up to $1,089,300 as of this year, which helps a little bit in the event a veteran has another outstanding VA loan and they want to be able to qualify for more. Like for us, our products go both ways. Someone qualifies for a second and a first mortgage at the same time, right? So it's just kind of done with one credit report. But again, different lending institutions could do it differently. Second mortgage does not need to be assumable. The VA has nothing to do with the second mortgage. You can call it. I'm going to give you a phone number, and I'm going to give you the options to click through to get speed dial to the VA. Because sometimes we'll do these, and people are like, well, no. I'm like, no. You got to talk to the VA because they're the ones who told me this. So kind of give you an example, again, just to kind of backtrack on what we did, right? Original mortgage, $500,000. Second mortgage at $165,000. Down payment of $35,000. Right? Even on a 15-year term, you're still saving a lot of money over getting an assumption or getting current market rates, right? Sometimes interest rates scare people off, but at the end of the day, they should be looking at the numbers. And again, we probably should have like a CPA in here to talk about like how you write this stuff off, because you have up to $1 million in mortgages to write off, right? But again, I'm not a CPA, that's my disclaimer. So this is there's no funding fee assessed in this. This is just straight educational purposes, just so you guys can see just the sheer dollar volume that people save, and that could be used as a tool to market your property a bit better. This is, we'll send this to you guys, but this is the Regional Loan Center. It's just option 1, 3, 2. And you'll connect with a live person. They will be knowledgeable, right? They are really good at what they do, and they'll answer it. The other information is from the VA handbook. This is my YouTube channel. I do videos all the time on every Thursday on just, and it's also in the newsletter if you guys see it, on different topics around VA home loans. And then I'm an MRP national instructor, so I did a video on updates for the VA loan. We'll be doing one soon again. I didn't bring cards. Christina, I don't know if you brought them, but this is our contact info. So if you guys have any questions, you guys can reach out.
I brought cards.
I did.
So you guys, I'll just add kind of at the end.
Yeah.
We talked about a lot of things that make it sound probably a little bit scary. When at the beginning we said, don't be scared. So I'll boil it down at the end just by saying, in all reality, like I said before, it isn't as complicated as it is unfamiliar. There's a quote that I love. This is not me rehearsing this. I posted it to my Facebook a couple of days ago. But something along the lines of, the soft spot for growth is found when we feel a bit insecure, right? So learn about things like this. It's like when I teach about FRPTA transactions, foreign sellers, or when I teach about any topic, 203K loans for renovations, and it's something that you don't do every day and maybe haven't even done in the last 20 years or maybe never, you avoid it. But there are over 1 million veterans in Maryland, Virginia, and DC. And veterans, from what I've seen, have been probably the most consistent source of referrals for real estate agents that there could possibly be. So by learning about this stuff, at least making yourself familiar and knowing that you have experts that you can reach out to, and David and I, MBH is the number one settlement company in assumption closings. That's actually not true, but I bet it is. Making sure that you're just making yourself aware of the whole transaction, right? We didn't talk a whole lot about the benefits on the seller side. We focused on kind of the benefits, like that example on the buyer side. But remember, there's no appraisal, right? So no appraisal required, and so oftentimes the seller is able to sell the property for a bit more, which is how you're getting them interested in the process. And it's not as scary as it seems if you just account for the fact that you might need more time, that you might get a little bit frustrated. If you've done a short sale, you've felt that kind of frustration in a different type of transaction. And it's such a huge benefit to both sides when the numbers make sense. So add it to your wheelhouse, add it to your toolkit, to make sure that you're getting those referrals by servicing veteran clients in the way that they should be serviced and at least knowing that these things exist. Yeah?
Christine, I have a question, just for clarification, because I thought I heard David say that there's no appraisal as long as there's no second loan.
Yeah, if you get a second mortgage, then the institution coming, but it's a, like from our end, it's a conventional appraisal. Okay, go ahead.
Two quick things. First, David, I think your email was wrong. There's no S.
Oh, no, yeah, there's no S at the end. Thank you.
Second is, what are the fees for your guys' seconds?
They're 2 points.
How do we get the your PowerPoint?
Are you going to, Gina's going to send it out with the correct email address.
I would just, for anybody who decides that they want to do this and get a seller, just, I made it a point to check with NDAR's legal counsel on advertising. Because I have sellers who are willing to allow veterans to assume their VA loans, and they have no interest in non-veterans assuming their VA loans. So I had to
good
has to
point.
Be careful not to violate fair housing or anything like that. Yeah.
Can we do that?
I'm not sure.
You can advertise it without violating fair housing, but it's a matter of wording and doing it appropriately. So, you know, there's no. Oh, you can't hear me? Okay.
There you go.
So you can advertise these things without violating fair housing, mainly because there isn't a protected class for things such as where the money comes from, right? Things like that. And so you can do it, but you always need to be careful as to how you're doing it. And I don't think it's a bad idea at all just to double check with counsel in whatever jurisdiction you're working in, or run it by an attorney who can take a look and make sure.
Yeah, that's the thing with these things too, because they can change all the time, is that little knowledge is dangerous. Because people will do a presentation, someone come up to us, you said this, I'm like, nope. So we said, like, that's not so. Yeah, so you guys always have our info without an asset bank, and then this is my cell phone number, but yeah, you can always reach out to us and let us know if anything comes up. But we'll be hanging around for a little bit. You got time?
I've got time.
Yeah, we'll be hanging out, answer any questions.
I have a question.